I'll just roll, we'll freestyle. All right, cool. So you guys weren't in the panel that I did earlier, were you? You guys been here the whole time? Sweet, awesome. My name's Matt Kelly. I'm a marketer more than anything else. I've actually never hosted an event in my life. I've been to a lot of events. I've spoken at a lot of events. I've never actually hosted it myself. So the event questions actually are not probably, I probably can't add that much value, but I've got some hopefully pretty interesting experience in terms of building your personal brand. And my thought process really going into this was thinking about the value that I can add for you as people who are either into the industry or entering the industry or wanting to move around the industry. So for me, personal brand is everything. So I had a couple of key points I wanted to talk through, but the first thing I really wanted to ask was, who's like current students? Everyone? Show of hands. Yes, everyone? Wow, okay, sweet. And who currently also works in the events industry or in a similar industry? Yep, a couple of you. So the rest of you want to go into the industry? You're currently looking for work or sweet? Yes, no, maybe? Okay, cool. No, it's good to know. It's good to know because for me, the most important thing with everything is personal brand and context, right? And what I mean by that is when you're going into an industry, even if you exist in it today, the way that I've found to grow the fastest is to build relationships, to build substantial relationships with other people in the industry, because relationships are everything. And I'm a massive technology geek. I love technology. I'm heavily involved. I use Twitter more than I use email. I'm literally so deep into tech, it's ridiculous. But I love it. It drives most of our business. It drives most of our revenue. We've actually, Just Media Design is a social media agency where we help businesses make use of social media, which is, again, not in the event space, but it's amazing that when you actually use social for good, that there's people there who pay attention, right? Because social isn't just about spamming. It's not just about pumping content out on Twitter, especially from a business perspective, because we've all seen that, right? We've seen the Facebook feed where you see Coca-Cola slam up 30 photos of a bottle of Coke in different models' hands. That's essentially all that they do. That's not what social is. Social is about actually building relationships. So I'm going to go there very shortly onto how to really scale relationships online, because I think if I was entering the industry today, that's what I would want to do. I would want to know everyone, and I would want all of them to know me. So on that note, I'll just touch really quickly on myself and my background, because that gives you the context to be able to understand my content. That's the most important thing. When I was 12, I believed I could do anything in life. Astronaut, sports star, movie star. I honestly believed I could do any and all of those things. At 16, I realized at a Broncos game that Carmichael Hunt was younger than I was, and he was on the Broncos field playing football. It's like, shit, I'm way behind. I will not be able to be a professional sports player. This is bad. I'm built like nothing. This is awful. So that was a horrifying realization for me. It was okay, so this stuff doesn't just come to you. It doesn't just gravitate to you. You can't just show up and expect things to happen. Because what everyone else does, everyone expects that when you walk in the room, they're going to be like, oh, you, great. Yeah, we'll give you this opportunity. For me, I realized very early on, it just doesn't happen like that. So I started to sort of discover content and marketing, and I did a couple of internships towards the end of high school and going into my first year of university, and I was like, sweet, creative, marketing, innovation, technology, that's where I want to spend the rest of my life, that's where I want to grow, that's where I want to be the thought leader at. So I went to university and that was fine. And a couple of years into my degree, I just remember sitting in the room and going, wow, this sucks. I'm learning about how to, I'm sitting on a laptop in a lecture, and I'm sitting there looking at MySpace, because that's what was cool. And I was just sitting there looking at that, and I'm listening to them telling us how to negotiate on the price of billboards. It's like, no one's looking at billboards. Why are we negotiating on billboards? Especially if 90% of people in the room will never ever need to buy a billboard in their career. And I'm sitting here learning about billboards. That doesn't make sense to me. And I'm watching some of the really creative brands do stuff really early with social. And that was a brain explosion for me. It was this is old. That's not what I'm learning right now is not valuable to me. I need to go deeper. I need to learn more. I need to get myself in this community. So I went on Tumblr, created a blog, and I just started to blog about funny campaigns, interesting campaigns, things that I was seeing in the industry happening. And then I started to run some social experiments. So one Sunday morning, I jumped on Twitter and I looked up NAB and Westpac and ANZ and a couple of others, St. George, and I just tweeted at them and I just said, hey, will you reply to this tweet individually? Just tweeted to each of them. And just to see, because Twitter was so important to me at this point in my life, I was like, let's see if it's important to them. And I got one reply about 8 hours later from one of the banks, and then the following day, the rest of them came through. And I was like, wow, they're literally ignoring customers. They're so paranoid about reaching customers during the week, and then on the weekend, when there's social, and that conversation scales, multiple people will see that chat, they don't care. That's interesting. So I remember summarizing this conversation and writing up the blog article, and I just seeded it out there. that was an interesting experience to me, to just do these random experiments. I would just try things on Facebook. I remember doing, like, do you remember, like, when you go to a company's Facebook page, it would be, like, sort of customized, and have either a big image when you first hit it. They don't do that anymore. It's really hard to do that now. But they essentially building a landing page, and I remember learning how to do that really early because companies didn't know how to do it. They didn't want to know how to do it. They just wanted someone else to do it for them. So I jumped down that role and started doing that, and things started happening for me, right? When I created content, people actually paid attention. And even though it was small, even though the socially responsive bank traffic I got from that was 20 people, I was pumped. I was pumped that 20 people found it, saw it, cared about it, and actually, like, a couple of people even, like, emailed me about it. It's like my mind was blown. So I kept going further down the line of content, and right towards the end of my degree, I found an organization called the Universal World Record Database. They're literally a database that holds the data for, like, Guinness World Records and a whole lot of other world record-based organizations. And I found out that to break a world record, all you had to do was have legitimate video footage of the record being broken, send it to their adjudicators, and they would check the content, and if it was legitimate and they could see if they could qualify the record, they would award you a world record. Like, sweet, I'm gonna break a world record. That's amazing content, awesome. Like, that's, no one I know in Brisbane has broken a world record. So a friend and I, 4.5 kilometres apart, arms up in the air, world's longest high five. Camera crew on each of us ran in, high-fived in the middle. Why is this relevant? I'll get there in a second, I promise. So we ran in, we high-fived in the middle, camera crew edited. Next thing we found ourselves on the cover of Bloomberg Businessweek magazine. The Huffington Post emailed us and they wanted to interview us. Why? Because we'd beaten two Canadians who had the previous world record. It wasn't a long distance. It was that we'd gone and seeked out an opportunity to actually converse with a community and create content or meaning with people that were excited, interested, curious, thought we were idiots, whatever it was. But people were interested. And what I learned from getting the longest high five and the world record was that by building that momentum, by just doing things differently, by trying things and by experimenting, that people paid attention. When I finished university, I went to a job interview with, I'll just shout out the company, Allianz Global Assistance, based in Toowong. Huge insurance company, you've all heard the name. And I remember it was a graduate position. I went into the interview, I was like, sweet, okay, so this is marketing, we're gonna talk about analyzing the competition and data and this and that and whatever. And not once did we talk about my degree, not once did we talk about marketing theory, not once did we talk about anything else. All we talked about in that meeting was world records, was about socially responsive banks, was about blogging, was about content, because that's what excited the guy interviewing me. He didn't care about my degree. The degree was just to get through the door. It was all the other stuff that I'd created that was actually meaningful. So from there, I went back to okay, more content. I got the job. I was like, sweet, awesome, that's cool, boring, but I'll keep doing it because I need money. Now I'm gonna keep blogging. Okay, I'm gonna write a book because I outsource work all the time. So I wrote a book on outsourcing, did really well, blew my mind. I was like, why the hell are people reading my stuff? But they were, because people don't go to the effort to create content. And then I created a video podcast with a friend. We started, like, that got featured on iTunes, and then that hit number one in the charts. And that was like another mind explosion. I was like, sweet. So no one's creating content. That's the problem right now. When you create something, people gravitate towards it. They actually care. They're actually interested. So I was like, awesome, we've got this crazy momentum, everything's working. And then I got a phone call from a guy that I'd met several years earlier who was based in Silicon Valley in a technology incubator. For those of you who don't know what that is, it's an organization, usually venture-backed with a crazy amount of money, billions of dollars, and they build new startups, new technologies, they want to compete with YouTube or Facebook or whatever. And that's what they build. And he'd seen the podcast, he'd seen that I had an interest in marketing, and he wanted me to relocate to San Francisco to work for the Monkey Inferno, which was the name of the organization. And for me, that was like the reality check. That's the goosebumps moment, right? That's the, whoa, okay, so now this is the way the world's going, right? The work experience at Allianz wasn't even on their radar. What was on their radar was the fact that I was actually engaging with people and actually creating content and spending the time to build substantial relationships outside of my job. I want to talk about why that story and why that's relevant. Because for me, brand equity, my life, the legacy that we create is all in who we are and what we actually put out to the universe, right? That sounds super airy-fairy, but I believe it, right? I believe that when you actually build momentum and actually create content and give it to people that's relevant and meaningful and inspiring, then people will actually react to it and will actually be interested. Going from that events, the technology space in San Francisco, and then coming back to Australia, and then coming to this event right now, I started to think about, like, what would be useful for you guys to learn? What can I give you guys? And so I've got some very specific examples of how, if I was in your situation, if I was finishing up study, if I was looking for a job in the space, if I wanted to eventually be a thought leader, an inspirer, someone of meaning in the space, like, what would I do? What would I do today if I had nothing, if I was starting from zero? And I've got a couple of very, very explicit examples of exactly what I would do, down to the platforms I would use online to build your thought leadership. So I'm just going to go through them because I think that's where you guys get the most value. For those of you who are actually interested, who actually are really like wanting to create content, and most don't, most people don't want to do that because it's time consuming and effort, and a couple of internships will get you the job that you want. That's fine. If that's all you want, that's totally cool. There's no judgment. That's fine. But for me, it was all about building a real career in the space that I wanted to get into. So I've got this idea, and I hope someone in this room or in the room that I'm talking to this afternoon, I hope someone does this because I honestly believe it'll work. At this conference today, there's 12 speakers who donated time to come and speak at this event. And I thought about that and I was like, sweet. So you've got 12 people there. I'm the least qualified to talk about events. There's got experts in their field over there, right? Those people have donated their time. You know they're not getting paid to do it. You know they're in that room because they care about events. As people entering the space, think about the thought leadership that you would get by networking with them. You could go and have a chat to them. You probably will at lunchtime. That's great. Send them an email. Want to catch up? That's fine. Offer to do free work for them. That's all fine, right? That's what everyone does. And that's probably part of the challenge, right? When everyone does that, it's really hard to stand out. So here's what I would do. I was thinking about like how you would build thought leadership in your space, and the one key point that I would do is think about how you would use those relationships to create content, because you can easily go out there and position yourself as a budding event planner, or even as an event planner, a growing event planner, whatever it is. You don't have to go out there and pretend to be an expert today, but I guarantee you, if you started a blog today, literally if you went to Squarespace or Wix or any one of the free networks that let you to create a blog, and then you created a Twitter account, and then you created a YouTube channel, right? Then you jumped on LinkedIn, and you just started to find the different people who spoke at this event, other people in the events industry in Brisbane, and you hit them up and said, hi, I was at the event, really liked your talk, wonder if I could interview you, either via Skype, record it, video content, or you might like send them an email and say, here's a series of questions. Ask them about their experience, ask them about what they do, ask them about their challenges in the industry, because they'll all be willing to do it. Everyone, that's ego, right? Everyone likes that. Everyone likes to feel loved in that space. But when you do that, you're building a crazy relationship. That's an insane relationship. They will never ever forget you if you do that, right? And then you can take that context, that meaning, that relationship, and then use that to reach out to other people. If I was in this room, I would be hitting up the top 100 people who have the word events in their job title on LinkedIn today. And I would be trying to build that relationship and offer to do something like that. Because they're not used to that. They're not used to being featured like that. They're not used to getting that sort of exposure. But that stretches far beyond just saying, hey, can I do an internship with you? Or hey, can I come in there and learn from you? Or can we have a chat? Or can we have a coffee, right? That's time and that's hard. But if you say something that scales for them, that they can then post on their Facebook page and brag to their friends about because they're excited, that's everything. That's like meaning. That's context. That's value, right? When the podcast Living Outrageously got featured on iTunes, the first 20 viewers, stoked, pumped, cannot believe 20 people actually downloaded that show. That's ridiculous. And it was hard. It was to actually create that content is hard. It's super time consuming. It's not easy. It's never going to be easy. It's always going to be difficult. But that's why we stand out. That's why we're on the homepage of iTunes, because other people just don't do it. There's plenty of thought leaders out there that don't want to do that. It's too much work. They're quite happy to sit in their room, in their office, and do their day-to-day job. And that's totally fine. That's totally fine. But if you want to take a step forward, if you want to get the exponential career growth that you can get, the relationships are all it comes down to. Even down to what your work that you're actually doing, that's the value. I've got a couple of other strategies that I think would be super interesting if anyone ever actually wanted to execute on any of them. Imagine if you created, who uses Twitter? Does anyone here use Twitter? Actively? Daily? Hourly? Not hourly? Okay, cool. No, that's cool, right? So for me, Twitter is the most powerful resource in the world. I use search.twitter.com every single day. It is, I think I mentioned it earlier, it's the core source of new business for us as an agency who deliver social media strategies, and it's not cheap stuff, right? Because we're actually on it day in, day out. And it's been crazy for me, right? I use Twitter every single day for that. But I was thinking about, for an events student, what could you do using Twitter to build your credibility, your thought leadership? If you created a Twitter account called Brisbane Events, right? Not Matt Kelly, not ABC Events Pty Ltd, right? Brisbane Events, make it off-brand, make it more emotive and feeling-based, more than about you and about your company. And then if you went there and searched every single event planner, event manager who's on Twitter, follow them, okay? And then start to engage with them. So when they post a photo of the last wedding that they did, comment on the wedding, right? When you see a big event, a big organization, they're hosting their big event, retweet them, share the love with them, right? You start to get traction. I guarantee you will build a presence. I guarantee you will get traction. People pay attention to that. They honestly do, because I'm used to putting out a tweet and getting no response, right? That's what most people are used to with Twitter. They'll just spam out links or whatever they do, right? Because no one's actually paying attention. But every professional speaking at this conference are all on Twitter. Half of you guys, a couple of you guys are on Twitter. Right? So we know there's people in the industry doing it, and you can actually search terms like events, geolocated around Brisbane and find the exact influencers you're trying to reach. By engaging with them there, it's a totally new layer to a relationship that who knows where that could go. 10 years time, that could come to fruition and they're gonna remember that you were the one who was telling to them about the first event they ever ran. That's meaning, that's context, that's building an actual relationship. There's a final point, there's a final little strategy that I like the idea of, very hard to execute on. If someone did it, I'd be blown away, I would actually love it. I would actually, like, I'll donate time to whoever wants to do this because I think it's pretty epic. Has anyone heard of a lead magnet? A lead magnet is a piece of content that you put on a landing page on a website and give away in order to attract leads, right? So it could be an ebook on the top 7 trends I see in events in Queensland, or it could be a video series on different presentation styles, or it could be the three venues I would use if I was an event manager in Brisbane, whatever it is, right? So you write the ebook, could be 2 pages long, doesn't matter, PDF it. Go to a website like leadpages.com, build a landing page with an email opt-in, name, put the product right there. Like literally have it right there. If they enter in their details, they get the product, right? And then use Facebook targeted advertising to target that to people in the events industry. Because what you're doing then is you're sharing value with them without even knowing who they are initially, right? And then they actually care about you because you added value first. So they, in their newsfeed, they see, because you've targeted an ad to people with events in their job title within 50 kilometers of the Brisbane CBD, hey, check out the free ebook on how to host your event in Brisbane. They're definitely going to click that. Are you kidding me? They work in Brisbane. They have to know what that is. They absolutely must know what's going on in that space. It's crucial. So for me, when I look at that and I go, like, how do you attract leads? How do you attract people in the space to build a relationship with? They're not necessarily going to pay you money to host an event. They're probably an event planner themselves. But it's a relationship that gives you can get so much traction from, because it comes down to adding value first, not second. It's not asking for something first. Because when you ask for something first, you're putting up a barrier or a hurdle, right? It's really, really hard to scale that. When you've got that hurdle, it's massive. It's near impossible. And I'm going to do something dramatic, right? Like, can I, like, jump or something? Make it look really awesome? No, I'm kidding. So for me, that lead magnet tool is massive. I wouldn't do it first. The Twitter stuff, easy, right? Super easy, right? Interviewing people, easy. It's one email, one-to-one. That's massive. That's meaningful. People actually pay attention to that.
What was that website for that you said before you were talking about Twitter?
Before I was talking about Twitter? What was I talking about? Squarespace. Oh, to create a blog? Is that what you're talking about? Yeah, so there's thousands of them. Wix, W-I-X, Squarespace is another one. If you're getting, like, really tech savvy, or you know someone in the space, then you could use something like WordPress and use a theme from ThemeForest. It's like, essentially, you can get a legit website up for $30, $40, $50 that looks substantial, actually has meaning. It's not like what it was 10 years ago when you had to spend 20, 30 grand to get a real website, right? Like, you can do that for really, really cost effectively. Hell, you can go on Tumblr and make a Tumblr blog, right? That's like 4 seconds to create that. I know that because Tumblr actually spent a crazy amount of time A-B testing, split testing, right? Grouping different cohorts and like changing the design of the page to see what would push people through the fastest. So I know that Tumblr spent making it easy. So I would even use Tumblr for the first shot, right? I would 100% be doing that. I would be using LinkedIn. LinkedIn is crazy. If you're not on LinkedIn now, like, sort that out, because you can search for anyone in your industry and everyone's willing to connect because they've been accustomed to it, right? They've been spammed for so long on the power of LinkedIn that they're just used to it. So the biggest thing I was going to say was, right now you can afford to not be scalable, right? It's not like this is just a hypothesis. Some of you may not be. Some of you might be crazy busy. But if it was me sitting down in this room, I would know that I've got 2 hours every night. I've got 4 hours every Saturday morning, right? I would use that time to do the unscalable stuff, to build the one-to-one relationships, using Twitter for that, because that's where the power is. And that doesn't pay off tomorrow necessarily, it could, but it could take 5 years. But when it does, the payoff is massive. For a year, no one watched our podcast. No one cared about it. We kept doing it every week because it was fun, we liked each other, it was a good thing to do. But when I got the phone call from Sean in Monkey Inferno in the US saying, Matt, saw the podcast, love the content, can we chat about you coming over? I was like, whoa, that's power, that's real, that's substantial content. So anyway, that's me. Sweet, thanks. I don't know, do we have time for questions? One, two. And if anyone has any questions or anyone wants to ask anything, yeah. Yep.
I think that it's a way to get information out.
Totally.
What's the best way to share that and get it out there?
Yeah. It depends, right? What most people do is they create the blog and they have it just sitting there live and they hope people will find it. And people don't, right? They just don't. I would use social as a driver to the blog. So I would use Twitter as a driver to the blog. I would, and the way, when I say that, I don't mean I would go on Twitter on a personal account and just like post about your blog articles 3 times a week, right? Like, to me, that's not what will do it. But go do the one-to-ones, right? Search out for people in the space, like related to the content you're talking about, and add value to them. So ask them a question about something they just posted, right? If Danielle from the wedding planner who's here today, if she posted a photo of the room that she decked out last week, right, I would definitely be responding to that, saying, hey, saw the photo, that was amazing. Because I guarantee you, she's posting them, and no one's saying that to her. I guarantee you. So I would be using platforms like Twitter to build the relationship first. And then when you get something that's super relevant, when they ask what we call a buying question, right, then you tweet them and say, hey, I just wrote an article about that, check that out. But I wouldn't go in that with that first. The other thing, if you've got any budget at all, Facebook ads are crazy. The guy standing in that corner with the video camera, right? That's actually my brother. I got him to come in because for me, content is everything. I said that, right? So right now we're creating content right now that I will be cutting up and using later on. I don't know what parts of it. There's a lot of randomness in here, but some of it I will, right? And for Michael last week, I said to him, right, like I want you to grow this business. He's got a videography business. He actually does wedding videos, right? And he's flat out as it is. But I'm like, no, let's do more corporate stuff. So we grabbed his last 4 videos, we cut it into, literally cut 20 seconds from each video, made a 2-minute-long video, posted it on his Facebook page, and then targeted advertised that to females 18 to 29 years old in Brisbane who are engaged. That's crazy. That's like, what do you see? Look, 3 hours later, you get like 7 likes, a couple of comments, and in the comments, people are tagging friends. A day later, one of them bought. That's a $2,000 wedding package they bought off a $2.50 investment. Right? The game's changed. It's totally different now. You can go so targeted at such a low cost, and that won't exist like that forever. It can't. Because Facebook know that people are leaving Facebook because they're getting too many ads. So my prediction is that they're going to reduce the number of ads that we see on the newsfeed and charge through the roof for them. Like, what's the wild, wild west of social media right now? If I can acquire users for 5 cents each, that's mind-blowing. In 10 years' time, I'll look back and be like, remember when email open rates, when 80% of people you sent an email to actually opened it? Right? Today it's like 6%. So I think I'll be looking back at social in 10 years' time and going, whoa, I cannot believe the power that we had back then. I don't know. I'd be using that stuff if I were you guys. But anyway, thanks heaps. I appreciate it. Awesome. Cool.